It was my pleasure to meet Jay Fitzsimmons last year at the GTO Nationals up in Seattle. Helped talk with him there and get this talk set up. Come on in. Jay joined the Australian GM Holden Engineering Group in October of 2000 and recognized the golden opportunity to adapt Holden's high-performance rear-wheel drive cars for release in the United States. He co-authored an unauthorized email to GM's new vice chairperson, Bob Lutz, proposing all of Holden's cars for North American release and naming the Monaro Coupe as a potential replacement for the Pontiac GTO. Recognizing the genuine GM passion and inherent practicality of the idea, Lutz responded directly, and a clandestine study was launched that verified the feasibility of turning the Monaro into a modern-day GTO. He was on a team of skilled Australian and American engineers who created the now infamously fast 2004 through 2006 GTOs. I give you Jason Simmons.
Yeah, that sounds really cool. Thank you. And thank you all for inviting me to come and speak. 16 years ago, when we wrote that email to Bob, we had no idea what was going to happen next, because GM had canceled the Firebird and the Camaro, and the company was really not in a very good place. What I'm going to talk about is basically how it all started, and some engineering stuff that happened during the course of the program. My job in the program was, I'm not an engineer, but my job was to do a lot of program project management stuff to help the engineers and the designers get the car delivered. So, for example, I was responsible for building all the prototype vehicles with the shop, and I was a build captain for the pilot build for the 04 car. And just general running around, I've done everything from talk to Bob Lutz directly to go and buy parts from America's Tire in California, which we'll talk about. So we'll talk about that, and then we'll talk a little bit about the design. We'll talk about hood scoops. We'll talk about some of the things about the car itself. Things that I tried to think of all the stuff that hadn't been reported in any of the media, that stuff you couldn't read about. So first we'll start off about Holden. Holden's design studio heritage goes back to 1969, when Bill Mitchell sent a man named Don DeHarsh to the Holden studio to set up a global South Asia presence of GM design. One of the cars that Don did is what you see in front of you, which is called the Holden Hurricane. And it was produced to, there's the unknown GM V8 architecture called the Holden V8 architecture, which came out in 253 cubic inch and 308 cubic inch, and it is unlike any other GM V8. It's one that nobody knows about, obviously, because they were only sold in Australia and New Zealand. This car was done to, as a package, to present the 253 V8 to the market. And it runs a 1963 Tempest manual transaxle. Mid-engine car, and it demonstrates a whole bunch of other technology that is not around in those days. It has a rear-facing TV camera. Obviously, it has some fancy entry and egress. It runs a hydraulic clutch brake system using an accumulator. A lot of inertia belts, a lot of stuff. Well, it had a guidance system, too, but that's an issue. Then Don's second car was this. This was intended to be a production car. It was fiberglass. It's called the GTRX. And it was built in about 1971 as GM's answer to the 240Z. And while we were researching the restoration of this car, which was restored after the GTRX, we found records of three of these being delivered to the design dome at General Motors with powered by 350 Chevrolets and turbo recommended. They were all painted in all sand. We found the invoices for the shipping. Although the GM Heritage Center has no records. This is the first Menorah, which Don DeHarsh was part of the design team for, and it ran a 327 Chevrolet and was the performance car for General Motors in Australia in the late 1960s, early 1970s. Ford and Holden dominated that market at that time, and this was General Motors' answer. And the first thing the Australians did with it is take it racing, which it did very well. Menorah dominated races like the Bathurst 1000 and other major races that they had at that time. So going forward to 2000, they decided that it was time for the Menorah to come back, and they made a show car called Maryland. And the reason it's called Maryland is because it's a drop top. And that is a very young, that's a very young Michael Simcoe, who's now the vice president of design for General Motors, driving Maryland, probably at the proving ground. It was a complete surprise for the industry in Australia. They had not expected Holden could afford yet have the gumption to turn their sedan into a coupe. And this is a cartoon of the time when it went to the Motor Show, or maybe it was the Sydney Motor Show, and for people are wondering where that Menorah came from. Simcoe drew it on a piece of paper on his wall when he was renovating his house. And that's how the form language for the Menorah was started. They put together a small team of people, and in the building that we ended up in for GTO, which was a converted gear assembly building, they renovated the cafeteria and turned it into an office. And that's where we did all the work for the GTO. The Menorah was done. And yet, they took it racing. Won the 24-hour Enduro not once, but twice in Bathurst. And if anybody knows anything about the Bathurst 1000, it is a bucket list race. It's a world race. You shouldn't miss it if you're in Australia and you're a race guy. That's the one to see. And the car, by then, the Holden high-performance cars were getting a lot of good press in the United States. And this has got to be one of the best one-liners you could possibly ask for launching a performance car. And it wasn't a Menorah. It was actually a Holden special vehicle sedan that won that little accolade. There's the line. But the real thing was that Hot Rod and other magazines had picked up on the rear-wheel drive and the fact that the El Camino was alive and well in Australia as well. So there was quite a bit of press coming out as to, you know, why was GM keeping this rear-wheel drive architecture in Australia and not selling it in the United States? And the truth of the matter is that they had planned on bringing it here as a Buick. GMX 127 in the late 1990s had failed because they couldn't find a design solution to move the fuel tank. The architecture could not pass the U.S. rear car-to-car impact test. That was our biggest obstacle in producing a GTO for Menorah, was to move the fuel tank and survive that very, very tough high-speed rear impact test. And we actually failed it the first time we tried. Okay, so I'm there. I'm hired by an American from La Crosse, Wisconsin, by the name of Jeff Jennings, and I was hired into the company to implement all the computing hardware and software for all the crash tests, aerodynamics, thermodynamics, structural analysis. Jeff was putting this team together. He was robbing General Motors globally of talent so that Holden could become an architectural design center, a modern one. And as two Americans, we're seeing these Menorahs and HSVs in Berkeley County. This can't possibly be kept from America. You know, what can we do? The environment at that time was Holden really wanting to stay off the radar because things had gone, although they had a wonderful start with Don DeHarsh back in the 1960s, things have not gone too well in Michigan for GM culturally. And the product was showing that, and it was not a good situation. So when we decided to write this email to Bob Lutz, we did so because he had actually published a mantra, so to speak, that said, who says? And he was basically challenging the company to, you know, do something and get passionate about the product. So we wrote this note when we showed it. And we wrote it, and it's funny, when you're going to write the big email, writing it and sending it, two different things. I'm just going to, hopefully this works. Jeff would not let me write it from my email address. He said he insisted on writing it from his because if anybody was going to get fired, it would be him. He wanted me to have plausible deniability. And he was serious. And I didn't realize how serious it was until we worked on this for about a day or two. Most of this, Jeff were here. We tried to get Jeff here, but Jeff's now the managing director for Harley Davidson Brewing Room in Yucca, Arizona. He's in the middle of product launches. So, and there is Mr. Lutz's response. When we wrote, he did not do email at that time. He actually let Betty Gonko, his admin. So his question was, we make a dynamite U.S. muscle car, how bad would federalization be? He's talking safety and fuel economy here, and how long would it take? So Jeff, I've never seen a man possessed like that. I was trying to help him. We put together a proposal within days, and we had a series of notes back and forth with him. This is the part of the pack that's in that. Let's see the attachments here somewhere. That's where we insisted that GTO. He wanted to put Monte Carlo in there, right? Maybe with the engine that we had in it, with the LS1 that the Australians were running, that was couldn't get out of its own way. That's the slide. There are a number of others, but this was the one that picks up. That was Bob now basically going ballistic and doing his own design. To read this. You guys can't read it. We'll come up and read it later. And there it is. That's the first acknowledgement that was the car. And he didn't slow down. But to give you an idea, if you don't know who Bob Lutz is, Bob had come from Chrysler. He'd come to General Motors to really rev up the product development side of things and the mindsets that had really affected GM since GM threw the DeLorean out and said, what part of 7-liter engines and 2 miles per gallon do you not understand? Which is a way. And the other interesting thing on this note is we start talking about new opinions. And arguably, even though I'm a diehard Pontiac fan, that's the car we should have done. We couldn't build enough. There were 4,000 Chevrolet dealers, and we could probably get 40,000 El Caminos out. That's not very many per dealer. But when you look at the Chevrolet showroom now, you think, well, they're selling that stuff. Mm-hmm. Easily traded El Camino. Here's more. Now let's talk about design. John Mack, designer for GM, came out and gave us the bad news, which was pretty much that Pontiac really wanted the car to look like it fit in on the showroom. They didn't want to take a lot of styling risk if they didn't have to. So the result was, there were some sketches. Some of this may have been published, but I have some other stuff in here that I know was not published. You get an idea for the sketches that were being done. This is put under Richard Colasso in 2002. No, project was known as GMX 281. And just here's some details on how to execute the Pontiac. Interesting story here, while we're on ignition keys, you may be aware of the recent ignition problems that General Motors had. We had a problem with the GTO. A certain vice chairman of product development had taken the GTO home over the weekend and went to drive it on Sunday and found that his battery was dead. But when the pickup guys came to pick it up, they said, your brake transmission shift interlock is not working. And sure enough, luckily Sunday in Michigan is Monday in Australia, and we got a call that said, you've got a problem with your ignition switches. And so, yours truly and some other involunteers were over in Adelaide at the plant the next day in 80 degree weather, doing some Red X sampling of our first production ship set. And so, which was involved 30 cycles of turning that ignition switch on and off. 30 cars, 300 cycles. I had about five guys that didn't want to do that, but did it anyway. And we had a problem which involved the internal mechanism of the ignition switch was hanging up. It was leaving the center stack powered on. It was leaving the ability to put the car in neutral. So it was not only a quality recall in the making, it was a safety recall. So we had a guy on the plane from the vendor with 1,000 tested good batch ignition switches on his way to Australia from, believe it or not, a company called Methode in Malta. So like the island of Malta, Mediterranean, and we fixed it. And every one of those cars left our factory with a good ignition switch. It was not easy. That was only the first of a few. There's the badge. There, I wish I had the other badge development images. I only have a few of them. There was a lot of angst around the badge. A lot of this reflects the desires of the brand team to have a fairly conservative approach. But here gives you some ideas of some, of at least for the engine we're badging. We really wanted to use a checkered flag. We wanted to use it on the engine cover as well. We felt it was an important part of the GTO's brand image that we wanted to keep. We're trying to keep as much of the historical brand image of the car as we possibly could. That we wanted to do desperately, because we couldn't do a hood tack. Obviously, we didn't get to. But that's one thing we wanted to do. Here's some shots in the studio, and if you were here for Bill Porter's talk earlier, there's the foam, there's the clay. The process hasn't really changed very much in all the years. Holden, like any other modern studio, uses Ilias Studio Surface software. And we get the clay very close to where it needs to be, and then we let the modelers finish it, put laser targets on it, scan it, get it back into Alias, and tune it so it's symmetrical and ready, doesn't violate any tooling rules or anything like. Holden is a very, very efficient process. It's a little bit time consuming, but they get very, very good results in terms of proportion. This was a very problematic, as any of you who own one of these cars know, not our best quality effort there. It has to do with the underlying structure not really having a good detachment area for it. And I mean, anybody who's in mass production knows that if, you know, these things are put on by a team of two people at the factory. They've got a high school education, they're probably hungover, and they need to put it on within Six Sigma, right, every time. And we just couldn't get it to work. And it's this line right here that we haven't looked at. There's the end product in red dioxide on the in the studio outside. There's the engine cover. I wish I had the other engine covers. There was a really neat one that had a raised and lowered sections of plastic to make it look like a checkered flag. That was my favorite. I didn't get one. And we had others that said Ram Air. They were, I don't have the picture. We did have some other, problems. As I said before, we moved the fuel tank from rearward of the axle to in the trunk. And just before the GM legal team was set to arrive at Holden to give us all U.S. legal training, which was basically how not to write bad emails that implicate the company, we ran a rear car crash test. And we had put in structural foam in these rails and other mitigation features to handle the load that was being generated by this rear car-to-car crash that we had to survive. And we moved the tank and put these in so you can see this. So the tank went from being back here to being up here. This is and we put this other device, we call it the flying V, which is a V-section compressed steel member, which it's designed as this beam collapses, it picks up the differential and shuts load out to the beams that way. Which is anything we could invent to manage the energy that was going on with that rear car-to-car crash, which was the direct result of the infamous email that got General Motors in so much trouble. You might may not be familiar with it. There was a famous rear car-to-car crash that they found an email where a guy who was designing, I think it was the Nova, said that they could have moved the fuel tank, but they paid out so much in wrongful death lawsuits versus the parts and tooling and development costs, and it didn't add up, so his recommendation was not to do it. That showed up in court, and General Motors got punitive damages for billions. So that lawyer actually came to Australia and was giving us the lecture. And our problem was we had trimmed the impact car about, as near as we could tell, about 5/8 inch too high. So when we did our crash test, it came over all of this and nicely vented 75 liters of fuel into the passenger compartment. It was crazy. So we showed this video to this lawyer. His suit was probably worth more than my personal car at that time. And this guy who had been lecturing us for a couple of days on the do's and don'ts of what to write and not write for General Motors legal in the United States, this, you know, very litigious environment, you engineers get subpoenaed. He reminded me of one of the Eagles from the Muppet Show. This guy starts giggling like a baby. We showed him our video. And our Alan Ford, who was our integration engineer for safety, said, we call this a setback code video. And if I don't have that, it will never be seen. But the result was this. So your 05, 04, 06 GTO will burn to the ground, and this thing will still be there. Sorry, it kind of ends up you can't really put 2 foot size golf club. You can get hit by a truck, you're going to be okay. So yeah, there's structural foam in the rails, it's now, and it was a godsend. We would have had an amazing safety problem if we had released that car. So it was a blessing. And then we had trouble with tires. For some reason, General Motors wanted us to use Goodyear Eagle RSA tires for the GTO. And I don't remember how that started, but we could not get them to stay on the rim. They would clock. We'd mark tires and the little dot would move 20, 30 degrees. And we noticed it because it started getting high-speed shape. You know, perfectly aligned cars getting high-speed shape. And we'd go into the garage. They marked some tires, and sure enough, the tires are walking all over the way. Turned out it was knee pressure. Apparently, Inky validated their wheel dimensions. That was okay, but at the end of the day, it was the tire did not create enough knee pressure. We It was not a high-performance tire. So we had a problem. We almost killed a guy, for one. He says, tire which came off wheel during traction control spin-off, April 4th, 2003. So we're almost in production for about lead time. And that tire come off the rim, almost killed this gentleman. It was obviously not a fan anymore. So we had a little ceremony. But we had no tire in the car, and it was bad news. So Steve Farrell and I, this is your chassis engineer, by the way. This is the GTO's chassis engineer, and he is one of the most consummate engineers you could ever meet. Man rolled his own cigarettes, didn't say much, wrote in tiny little print and tiny little notepads, and he would spend hours with the car to prepare it. He'd walk in, the mechanics would say, "Steve," just like Norma Cheers, and they'd have three or four sets of bushings, and ended up being tires, and he would go drive the holy crap out of these cars, come back, have a cup of tea, a cigarette, while the mechanics change the car over, and then he would take all that, his own information, and sit with the computer Adam's car guys back at the engineering center and talk about how the car felt as they were looking at options on the computer model using a software called Adam's car. Anyway, long story short, we didn't have a tire. Steve said, "We've got to have tires, I've got to have something to develop, otherwise we're dead." So we got on the internet, we went to America's Tire, and we were browsing through all the tires, just because it's a great source for data. I mean, tire racks like that, man. I don't think a tire rack was around yet. Anyway, we're on America's Tire, and he finds the Goodrich KDW. He goes, "That one looks good, no silicone." So I got my Jeff Jennings credit card, and we ordered 8 sets of tires from the America's Tire in Newport Beach, California. And they were shocked. They had to do all this credit card verification. Got them shipped over, and we also shipped a set to GM North America, who put it through their TPC test, and sure enough, it survived. This is, they shaved it down 80%, deflated it, and they put it on the, at that point it was like an old C-Series pickup. They went through this brutal, and it survived. It was a little heavy, a little too much unsprung mass, but that's how the CompTIA KDW got there, thanks to America's Tire. The problem, though, was, at that time, BF Goodrich was owned by Michelin. And Michelin would not supply General Motors. They had banned them. And so we didn't know how we were going to get tires. And the only way we managed to get tires is the Michelin people agreed that because the car was being built in Australia by GM Holland, that they would supply the CompTIA KDW to Holland. They were going to supply anything to Indiana. There's number one coming off the line. That's Chris Milan, one of our chief program engineers, pushing it off. It didn't start. It started over here, but we couldn't wait. For some reason, I think the battery was down. All these cars got tested and retested and had people with clipboards coming up and checking it all on the line. They often suffered battery issues. That's the first one coming off the boat at Benicia in California. We're just in from the bay, the Golden Gate Bridge. That's Russell Maney, who is our U.S. coordinator. And although I've never seen any pictures of it or film, apparently that guy got in a lot of trouble because as soon as he got down here, apparently he just smoked him. True story. There was a big hoo-ha about that. Just literally lit up. So Now we'll talk about the 05 car. Which, this is Richard Klotz's sketches on my notebook paper from about 2001. I told him I was going to save it, and he says, I'm not signing it. That is the first ideation sketch for the appearance, external appearance. We ended up changing a whole bunch of other stuff. There's this official sketch. We worked a lot on the hood scoops. In fact, we were ready to make them fully functional. Absolutely. So, and that was the big debate. Should they be functional or not? Is it really a GTO if they're not functional? And then Bob Lutz ruled, he says, as long as it puts air into the engine bay, I'm happy. So, okay, you're in charge. But we did do the work. And there's the positioning computer layout for the intakes, as we were calling them. And there's the computational fluid dynamics analysis snapshots showing the airflow. They definitely flowed enough air to power the engine. We got to the point where we were trying to line up a supplier. I think it was Magna in Europe. They were ready. It was going to be a clamshell. It was going to come down and basically use the lower part of the existing airbox and just, it was going to be a plenum. Let's see here. That would then just drop on, drop right down on top. Airbox with a little bit of a foam, not unlike 1969, and voila. Well, what we were really worried about is getting the water out. It would have been piece cost, it would have added some money to the car, and it would have been a risk from the schedule. But we said, well, we've got the other pieces, we can always just go with this, and you could roll it out as a special edition, you could do whatever you want. Functional hood scoops were definitely ready. And then here's another note I thought you would enjoy. Is it really, if you could read it, it talks about Bob reacting to an article by, who is this Bob again? And it was a press article about what was a real GTO. And here's Bob poking fun at himself. Unless the word boy racer theme, we can't live off of 70-year-olds who reminisce about the great GTO. Yeah, he was 70 at the time, so you can say that. And the funny thing is, I don't know if you saw it in one of the other emails that I showed you, but down here. He wrote to Jeff and I, he wrote Lutz in parentheses in one of his replies. I don't know if you caught that. As if we didn't know which Bob we were writing to. And that's, although the guy comes across as a real kind of blood and guts, marine fighter pilot type of a guy, captain of industry, he's actually one of the most honest, straightforward, conscious people I've ever met. Extremely smart, very humble. There's a series of slides that show Jeffrey Haggerty's sketches of some hood scoop ideas that so gets a progression of how we thought about doing it. Now Jeff went off. He even did a shaker. Hood scoop. We're all car guys. We're going, well, if we're doing scoops, we're going to try a shaker. And how would you do that? He says, well, just use the engine cover. No, too mobile. And here's some clay development. This is actually working design images that Jeff gave me. We're trying to get the dimensions and proportions right, trying to get it to work with the grill. And here's another series of images of the top plan view of the clay model. Look at this now, I don't know which wall is actually going to be. You can see the two things. It's just a question of where to put them. We just use the O4 clay model. Well, as I said before, Holden was the design studio is very conscious of working proportion first, detail second. So your initial look at something pleases your eye, and then as you get closer, you look at and you see the details, and it just gets better. That's the way they work there. Other studios tend to just need to get it out the door. And they don't worry about proportion as much, so Holden would tend to sort of hold off on details until they have proportion. That's why you see all these workups. Who's ever going to see that? You can see the video. Here's some of the people. This is another area where we had some problems with the rear fascias, managing this gap, and also managing the plastic along this edge. The end product turned out pretty good. Here's some images, a couple of CAD images, and then a foot slam test with the scoop inserts. They did pop out the first time. So we had to work on the pins. Not the first time, after not the not enough slam. I think the overall turned out pretty good. I like the carbon for this. The other thing we did for the 05, 06 car was the exhaust system. Now the 04 car, obviously, has a true dual exhaust system, just exits on one side. And that was for our benefit, so we didn't have to do a rear fascia. We had to do it for 05. But we thought, well, if we're going to do this, we've got a 6-liter engine, we've got to get this thing to sound right. Otherwise, why? Why even bother? And we had gotten in touch with all the guys locally that owned GTOs in Melbourne, which was the Muscle Car, US GM Muscle Car Club, and the Pontiac Club. We had invited them all to come into Fisherman's Bend and Holden, bring their cars, didn't matter if they were original or not. And we had a big meet and greet, and ate food, and looked at cars, and it was more to get all the Aussie side of our engineering team familiar with what we were talking about, you know, because why are these Americans all worked up about this GTO? We just do an SS. So we showed them that, and there was one car that just sounded awesome, and it was a 64 GTO that had been delivered new to Australia, converted steering wheel, and stayed there its entire life. And this guy, Jack Harris, very quietly spoken guy, brought this car in, and we're all going, listen to that. And so I talked to him, and it turns out the car had its original exhaust system under it, but the mufflers had been swapped with 1969 Ford Falcon HO mufflers. And the Falcon HO is the quintessential Australian muscle car. It's 351 Cleveland, downrated, it's probably 400 horsepower, and it is a monster of a machine. They sell for nearly $500,000 now. Not an oil painting, it's a four-door, but that was the mufflers he had under this GTO, and it sounded great. And there was one other thing about it, obviously O4 is also interesting. It's a dual, which is, you never know. Look at that box. There's Jack, there's his car. Notice the license plate. It had a 421 HO. And we took it to the proving ground and dropped some sound bites on the noise room. And there's the truck. 421 HO. And we sent the tape, the recordings to Tenneco, who was the, you might know as the parent company of Walker Dynamax. It said, we know we can't do the decibels because it won't make it through pass-by noise. Give us the tone quality. And they said, this is what you want. We said, this is what we want. And it took them about four tries of playing with baffles and stuff, and I think we got it. And we said, it needs to sound like a gorilla would go to the house. And he had a great time. This is a Saturday. There's nobody else around. And here comes this old GTO. The guys call from the guard gate. Is this guy here with an American car? And, do you know about this? Is Jim Fitzgerald here? So when the 05 came out, they did the press release at the Andre School. And I got some images. I wasn't there, but I got some images from it that I think really spell out how he felt about that car once we drove it. And what you see here is Bob is driving. That is Reese Millen's Drift GTO, some of you might be familiar with. And he is passing him through a fairly tight corner on the outside. You can see she's at full compression here. He's working a little opposite lock. And he's getting by. I thought this really spells the spirit of the car, because this is what it was all about. And you can see he's still under acceleration here, and now he's in the brakes. And then there was a second image on the brakes. Now he's in the brakes. You can tell his lights on. So he's gotten by him on the outside.
Can you back up one slide? Did you take that jump?
You went to Reese.
Yeah, Reese. Who is it? They just loved it. They had a great time. I don't even know this guy, so. And we got this image as part of the image set, and it just looks like, and everybody's got this shocked look on their face, like, what have you just done with our car? There's the 05 coming from Venetia. That one's obviously going to the first one. There's Russell again, and Adrian Purnell, our electrical engineer. And to wrap it up, this is kind of what they were trying to do. This is what Les was trying to do. He was trying to show GM as a company that it could be done. And it didn't take a whole heck of a lot to put some small team together and get a really, not perfect, but hopefully a memorable car out in the market. And this is what he said back. And here we are. Small group of guys. Just all car guys. That's my friend Jeff Jennings. Oh, great story. The second time Lutz came to Australia was to drive the 05. And by then, everybody was really fawning to Mr. Lutz, because if you said the right things, you got a program. You got our GTO program. So they had all these cars lined up, including the all-wheel drive GTO, the Coupe 4 that they sold in Australia was there. Lutz just walked in and got in an '05 GTO, took it out onto the high-speed loop, drove it as fast as the car would go, came back in, fished out a cigar, and said, "You've improved on perfection," and spent the rest of the day on his cell phone. Didn't drive another car. And what he was doing was apparently he was part of a consortium that was going to buy an ex-Navy F-18. They're trying to buy it. We're in the middle of negotiating, they didn't get it. But he spent there, he did not drive another car the whole day. But what he didn't know is both of the 05 GTOs that were there that day had blown their differentials 2 days prior. And we, I had to fish differentials out of the garage and wherever I could find them to get them. My integration engineer just took him out and blew him up. He comes back and says, "Brakes don't work very well." I'm going, "Well, that's because there's diff oil all over the back wheel." "Oh, that's a problem." So, "Do you know who's going to be here in like 72 hours and it's Friday and there's no overtime and WTF?" But that turns out that's what he did. He got in the car and just hammered it. And then didn't drive anything else. That's the two launch cars. That was this one. This one was at LA, and this one was at Detroit. They repainted this one. I don't know why. This is one you see with Lutz and Leno. Here's Richard, who also is a very successful designer. That's Jeff and myself and the gang, the Proving Ground. Not a big team, just a real awesome group of people. I'm really honored to be here, standing at the top for them. They're all Australian, except for Chris. And her husband, Richard, isn't there. Yeah, most of them don't work at home anymore because they stopped the engineering and manufacturing of automobiles there. Engineering was finished a year ago, and manufacturing stopped a few months ago. So no more Chevy SS, the Caprice cop car. Any questions?
I'm following through on what you just said, that they still didn't do the design work there?
Yeah, design studios, Lattermore, yeah. In fact, I think they're building a new facility. Because the old one was built in like 63.
They must be doing something really like
Yeah, design-wise, we after GTO, I went on and built some show cars with projects and restored the Hurricane, which I showed. That car came out of a museum, a little museum in rural Australia. And they did a pretty good job with the Denali XUT show car and some other ones. And they, yeah, they're design studios.
I think I read someplace was the intent only to do the 3 years, 4, 5, and 6, and that's going to be it?
Initially, yes. And then they knew there would be a gap until we could do enough of the next architecture, the VE architecture, which is the Camaro. And I do have some sketches of those cars as GTOs and as Firebirds.
Do the Monaros in Australia have the same strut rub problem, or is it because our wheels were different, or
what? Well, they have, I'm not familiar with the problem with it. Oh, the bushing problem? Yeah. It's just a bad bush design.
Can you
account
for that, or was it a replacement?
I'm not sure. I'm going to make a confession here. I've never actually owned a GTO. I'm a Firebird guy. three second gen Firebirds, two Formulas in a wickedly ugly brown 77 Trans Am.
Yeah,
I think
they're talking about that strut rub there, but there's an issue with some of the cars and had an alignment thing, and there's some debate about what it is, but basically the inner part of the tire will hit the weld where the strut and the spring seats with the strut are welded together.
Oh.
And it'll wear a groove in the tire, and then the tire will blow out.
I was just thinking there's a hydraulic bushing. that if you do a, like a Rockford turnaround of the car, it will pull that bush apart.
You're talking about the radius arm?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's what I thought. So there's aftermarket stuff, you know, for that. I think that the general, the folklore here in the U.S. is that they buy wheels on the GTO and the Holden, and that is the genesis of that problem, is that the car was based on had a narrower tire, and so that was never really a problem over in Australia.
No, the HSV on their car was put in 19. I'm not sure why they were going to
the offset problem.
We have, that's actually another story. We had to do an offset from a crash because we were concerned about when you put a wider wheel, like an 18-inch here, in that case was the wider diameter wheel. When you hit offset, it'll stack that wheel up into the footwell, and it'll break your ankles, or they call it footwell intrusion. And then there's another test. When you test the car, you've got to be able to open the passenger door with a certain amount of force. And initially, the Monaro did not pass that test with the 18-inch. We had to lengthen the striker on the passenger side by a couple of mil. Luckily, that was all we needed to do. And then you could open the door.
Okay, the problem you talked about with the key, I've got that problem still today with my 06. It's my wife's car, and she comes and she can pull the key out, but the radio and everything still stays on. Put the key in and keep pulling it out quickly, you can eventually get that center stack to pop out and shuts everything on.
That's what happens when you like flip it off and pull it out really quickly. It'll leave the center stack powered up. You'll be able to turn the wheel and put it in the neutral.
Right. So it's still there, or parts of it are still there.
That's interesting. I'd take it to, I guess you have to take it to Chevrolet.
or Buick.
I guess I have one other question, safety related. Can you confirm that the driver's airbag is not the cop?
Oh yeah, no, it's automotive.
So I knew the passenger side was, so, because it's real hot.
So the cars arrived in LA without the rear spoiler? Do you know the story?
They arrived to Phoenicia in San Francisco, and they had the spoilers.
They didn't.
The first bullet of the cars ended up getting a software revision to their clusters. And it was cheaper to actually change the cluster out than to do a flash of software. So I have a picture of one of our electrical engineers, Paul Gibson, drop kicking a GTO cluster into San Francisco. But they set up a big tent and they just moved them all through. We were flying pretty close to the wind, as close as it gets for quality for that car, to get it done in 18 months.
And then the other thing that's going to happen is all the engineering pages of the fuel tank, the all the engineering pages of the narrow stages that have done the full tank, fuel tank, but there is a discussion about having all the two-door versions go to the
And they stopped building the narrow so shortly after GTO was finished, they couldn't just in
back. Where did the SAP program come from? Is that going to be an option factory, or were they all
sport appearance
package?
Oh, I think that was all Pontiac marketing through the dealers.
Yeah. Okay. So 100% was dealer installed.
I seen an article a while back in one of the car magazines that GM was going to do another GTO, but it was going to be under the Buick line. Is that true?
I heard something about that too.
Yeah.
I poked my source of all sorts of Mr. Wangers, and he hadn't heard about it, so he's got ears everywhere. So.
I just wondered if it was true or not. You still work for GM? Or?
Nope. I left GM in 2010. I worked for Boeing. Not on the sales.
No.
He's in the military. Exactly. Just cool stuff. Another good story. Some of you might be aware of that the car is equipped with a shift light. It's on the little telltale on the Western Cluster, and if you can get someone to get into the tech tube, you can turn it on. And it will calibrate it to flash and beep at you if you need to grab a gear. And Bob Reuter, our GM North America chief engineer, decided at the end of the day that it was too intrusive. He didn't release it. And you can't turn it on if you go into it. Somebody's got a tech tube with a full license. So it's a pretty expensive tech tube license, so it's going to be a major mechanic.
Maybe it's been covered in other forums, but I see in a lot of your, most of your photos of the design stage, there's never a picture of this car with the spoiler. Even two intro cars, didn't have the spoiler in the back. Was that a production delay, or was it just, maybe, like I said, no?
The only problem we had with it is that detached in one of the crash tests, it became an issue, but...
But your intro cars didn't have one on there?
They were talking about making it an option. And because they were desperate for options, and the marketing guys were just, first they were really kind of, didn't know what to do with the car. And then when they were basically told what they were going to get, because we didn't have enough time to do much else, like a sunroof or and stuff like that, who knows what they would charge for that thing. But no.
Can you remind us again what the rush to production was?
It was, we had to get the car in quickly because there were going to be some safety changes in North America. And they wanted to get to market quickly because they had this gap with the Camaro and Firebird not being available anymore. And we committed to an 18-month schedule to get it done. So that was about half what they really thought we could do. And they were good.
It was funny, I had quite an influence financially on the final design. It was quite a lot of feet from the team, you know, a lot of trouble stuff, like, no, the rear mirror internal was all the narrows had the auto dim, we don't have that. Quite a few little bits and pieces that were trimmed out.
Yeah, they had a lot of discussion about that. They didn't like where the window control switches were. I wouldn't say decontented. They picked what they wanted on the current company.
Just a question back to where you're talking about them replacing the gauges. Do you know what build date, like, the car stopped at on the first boat? Because I ordered mine in June of 2003. And I thought mine was supposed to be on the first boat, but people were getting their cars way before mine. Mine showed up in February of 2004, and I was wondering if mine was one of those. It's a November 2003 build.
Yeah. You know, I wrote down, I got a report of the first boatload of all the things. I can't find it. It's in my boxes that came back from Australia, because I was thinking fins are going to be important. Mm-hmm. And marketing had already talked to us about that. And the problem they had was a couple problems. When they rolled out the red car in Los Angeles, so I'm told by Mr. Simcoe, Bob Lutz and Lynn Myers were standing there basking in the glory when the chairman of the California GM Dealers Association approached Lynn Myers and said, "We will take them all." And she apparently didn't. He said, "No, I'll write you a check today, and we'll take them all." He goes, "I've got dealer lists that are 10, 12 deep. We'll take as many as you'll give us." And apparently, Lutz just looked at him and patted her on the back and said, "Nice problem to have." Just walked away. What happened was, so I'm also told, this could be good bar, but I know that the first three or four boats of cars somehow got stitched up by a Northeastern U.S. Dealer Association. And they just went, "You want a car? Talk to us." Mm-hmm. Meanwhile, they parked them and were sending us battery recall stuff by the dozens. And nobody could get any cars. Where your car ended up, I don't, yeah. Maybe someday somebody will get into the Holden system and figure that out. I used to have quarry access to that.
There's, of course, the transmission lockout. But is there also one you keep if you go from first to fourth? My son claims there is. He goes to the track, road track, and says, so find out how to put the wires when you go.
No, it doesn't have that. No. Skip shift? No.
So that, to keep you out of reverse at the wrong time is the only shift lockout?
Well, thank you again for having me.